Actually, this particular song has special meaning because this song was played during a healing process that I received through Jesus. So, yeah, it's a very special song.
Tripping right now is gonna take over the living room and give her testimony. I'm gonna go ahead and mute all except Red Nose, just so we don't have any background noise, any wild parrots, cell phone rings and all that stuff. So
nothing else, Jesus. coming back to where we started. Coming back to where we started. When I first felt your love. You're all that matters, Jesus. You're all that matters. Coming back to what really matters. Just your heart. Just wanna bless your heart, Jesus. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. Never wanna leave. And oh, I'm not here for blessing. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything. I just want you.
Oh, hi, everyone. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Tiger. Thank you, H, for building this world, first of all. I really deeply appreciate it. This morning during service at my church, where I live, this verse was brought to my attention and it has stuck with me. So I thought that I would add this to my testimony. And it's Ephesians 3, verse 14 through 21. And it is actually a prayer. I'm just going to go ahead and read it. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives his name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through the Spirit in his inner being, so that Christ will dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and how high and deep is his love of Christ, is the love of Christ, excuse me, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do for sure, I can't pronounce that word. I'm so sorry. More than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. So I'm going to start out with just a little bit about me. And I was born in Jersey, and I am 57 years old. I had four sisters and three brothers. One of my sister has passed away, so three brothers and three sisters. So I'm just going to go ahead, and I am going to jump into my 30s. And which would be the first picture you'll see. This is me, the little guy. And this picture is me in my 30s. And when you look at this person, she had a past. And that past was into witchcraft. It wasn't something that was bred into me. It wasn't a family thing or anything like that. I chose it. A free will. I had literally chose it. And being in witchcraft, at the time, consumed me. And I did what I had to do to move forward. And not proud of it, but I did it. And I did it for power. That's why I did it. I did it because I was able to do things and see things. That's why I did it. I'm just gonna get, that's just a little bit about it. And I'm just gonna go ahead and go to the next picture. And this is me and my late husband. And I am in my 40s in this picture. And I was still in witchcraft, and I was slowly getting out of it. Things just didn't seem right. So I slowly was getting out of that. So this one, I'm in my 40s. That one, I'm in my 50s. Towards the closet door. And I was home, and I didn't hear anything or know anything, and I went into the office of my home, and I found my husband on the floor. With a self-inflicted gunshot wound to the chest. And I, visual never leaves, so I'm just gonna leave that alone. And, I was, numb. I was at a loss finding him laying there. And, we, was pretty numb. I didn't know what to do or where to go or even fathom the fact that I just couldn't do anything. It was just numb. So my son was there and my daughter-in-law were there, and they tried to help. And my daughter, they made all the arrangements because I really couldn't focus or do anything. And I mean, I was just in a state where whatever anybody wanted, I would be like, whatever, just do what you have to do. I don't even know what to say. So they took very good care of everything for me. And then I remember, I guess they figured that I wasn't around because I was such in a numb state, and I was kind of like a zombie just going from room to room. And I guess they didn't realize I was there, and I would overhear them speak and say things like, she's going to need some mental help, she's going to need this, she's going to need that, and things of that nature. I mean, I heard it, but I didn't react on it. I was just saying to myself, hey, you know, I'm going to move on, and that's it. Moving on wasn't very easy, but I tried. And my daughter left and went back to college, and my son stayed behind, and my son has his own family. I mean, he's a father, he's a husband, and he had his own responsibilities, but he stayed with me. He stayed with me for 2 weeks, and he didn't want to leave me, but his wife said that it's time to come home, and I didn't want him to leave, but I knew he had to leave. And I didn't really do anything. I didn't even cook or anything like that. I just went through the motions, just literally. And then my son decided, well, Mom, it's time for me to go home with the kids, and he had children. So there was some guilt there. Although I did want him to stay, I knew he had to leave. So throughout all that, as soon as he left, I was like, okay, now I can do whatever I want. It's okay. I can just do what I need to do. Well, the first thing I did was buy a case of wine. And I brought it home. And that's all I did. That was it. I would just drink. And it would help me sleep. But the odd part was, I would fall asleep and I'd wake up like nothing. Like I never drank. It would like disappear. I was like, well, the numbness is gone. You know, I back to square one. And then I would drink again next day and fall asleep, wake up. It was like nothing happened. So then I decided to try some pills. And I don't know how to explain this, but that didn't work either. I felt absolutely nothing. It didn't work. I just... drink them. I would actually take them with alcohol, and they didn't work. So, excuse me, I'm sorry. And so I continued, and it's the fourth week into his death, and an angel appeared, which is the next picture. This woman, I call her Mom, and this woman knocked on my door, and I really didn't want any visitors. Actually, I didn't want anybody else in my house because I just felt that they would control the situation. And I just wanted to do what I wanted to do. And I opened the door and she came in. And she had a casserole dish. And she put it on the counter because I wasn't hungry. So I told her, well, just go ahead and have a bite to eat. Well, she went ahead and she made a plate for me, and she made a plate for herself, and we sat down at the dining room table, and she prayed. Of course, I was just huffing and puffing. Like, who does she think she is? Kind of attitude. She's 83. I believe she was 85 years old. But she walked through my door, and, she was relentless. She just kept coming back. And out of respect, I wasn't rude to her. Out of respect, I didn't kick her out. And thank God knew who to send. So 2 days later, she came again. 4 days later, she came again. And she just would not leave me alone. Just would not leave me alone. And I was trying to build up the courage to really kick her out. And I didn't want her in my home because all she talked about was God. And I was like, yeah, really? And she prayed for me. And then one day, I think it was like the 10th time she was over, she gives me a prayer book. And of course, I received it. And there was a prayer that she highlighted that I should pray And of course, I didn't do it. I just took the book and put it to the side of my nightstand. But she says, "Well, we're going to pray anyway." So I just bowed my head, and she prayed. And this lasted for about a month. She kept coming over, and she'd pray, and kept coming over, and she'd pray. And then one day she invited me to church. And I'm like, that's not going to happen. I'm not going to do that. So I said, "Well, you know what, sweetheart? This is where I draw the line." I said, "I'm not going to church." And I continued, "Hi." And I said, "No, I'm not going." So she said, "Well, we'll pray about it, okay?" I said, "Yeah, go ahead. That's fine." You have to understand, I wasn't disrespectful to her, but I did have an attitude toward anything of faith or anything of religion or anything like that. And then she said, "Well, you're welcome at my church." I said, "We have two services, and you can come at any time you want. You can go to the morning one or the afternoon one." So June of 2018, I woke up. It was a Sunday. I didn't want her to know, though. I didn't want her to see me. I decided to go to a church of my choice, not the one that she said. I wanted to go somewhere where I wanted to go, not where someone told me to go. Believe it or not, the church I went to was her church. And I went in 15 minutes late because I just didn't want to be noticed. And I sit in the back pew, and I said to myself, "Okay, well, that didn't work. Something said try another church." And I did. I tried another church. I went home. I said, "That didn't work." So I went home, and guess who shows up that Sunday? She did. She says to me, "I saw you at church." I'm like, "What? There's no way. There's no way you saw me. No way." She goes, "Yes, I did. I saw you." I said, "I tried to run after you, but you left so quick." And she's right. I did leave quickly. So she says, "Well, I'm going to church next Sunday. Do you want to go?" I said, "Oh, I don't know. I don't. I tried it twice. I'm not going again. It's just not for me." And she says to me, "You know what? I need a ride. Do you think you can take me?" Said to her, "Okay, I'll take you." So the following Sunday, got dressed, picked her up. She says, "It's going to be a glorious day, Allie." And my nickname is Allie. And she's like, "It's going to be a glorious day, Allie. You're going to love it. You're going to be fine. You're going to be okay. I know it. I know you're just going to be fine." So I picked her up, drove, got at the church. And I sit here. Her daughter sits right beside me, her husband, and another couple, which were related. And then on the opposite side, she sits here, and three elderly women sit beside her, which were her friends. And I felt trapped. Felt like I couldn't move. I felt like I couldn't go to the left or go to the right because I didn't want to be rude. And I was like, say to myself, "I got to get out of here. What are you doing here?" So the songs started playing, and the emotion just started taking over me. It's like, what's going on here? And the songs continued and continued. then I just bowed my head, and I would be crying, and she would put her hand on my knee and say, "It's okay, don't worry, you're going to be fine." And I'm going, "No, I'm not. It's getting worse." And then the sermon started. Pastor Hilton, this was his name. And 1 Corinthians. And he started preaching about love. And it had to do to the believers. And I'm like, "Well, I'm not a believer. Why are you telling me about love?" And his message was so bold and so forward. It was like he was yelling at the congregation. Then I realized I wasn't listening until I was listening. And as he spoke, it was an overwhelming feeling that was just stirring in me and was just being lifted. And it was like the pain. And I can't explain it very well, but I'm going to try so that you can understand the amazing love God has for each and every one of us. It is not phony. It is the most richest type of love you can possibly feel. It is a sense of compassion, a sense of understanding, a sense of wanting. And I couldn't react but to just cry and just say, "I want it. Yeah, that's what I want. I want to feel that love." I've never felt love like that. I didn't even think it existed. So as the sermon continued, I just kept crying. And I wanted to leave. I did. I wanted to leave, but it was like these two barriers were put up where I couldn't go to the left or cut to the right. And it was just, I was supposed to be where I was supposed to be. So then came the time where he goes, "If there's anybody that would like to dedicate their life to Jesus Christ, it's as simple as raising your hand." And I didn't at first. And then he said it, and it sounded like a trumpet, like really loud. And he says, "Is there anyone that would like to surrender their life to Jesus Christ?" And I went, "Yes, it would be me. I want it." And Betty, that's her name. Her name is Betty. I still call her my mom. And then Betty goes, "Sweetie, I'm going to go up with you, okay?" And I said, "I really would like that. I really would." So I went up. It was a prayer like I've never heard before, but so simple and so easy. You dedicate yourself and you believe in Jesus Christ as true Lord and Savior. Yes. You surrender your sins. I said, "Yes." And he says, "Welcome, my sister in Christ. Welcome." And I am a believer. I am a believer of Jesus Christ. That is who I am. I am his servant. And It was quite overwhelming that day because people were coming over to me and saying, "It's the best decision you've ever made. Thank you, my sister in Christ. You can. We're having this class. We're having that class. We're going here. We're going on this journey. We're going to sight and sound. We're doing and all these invitations and everybody just surrounding me with all this love and welcome here and welcome there. And I'm going, so overwhelming, but yet so awesome." I couldn't say yes. I couldn't say no. I couldn't say anything. So then came October 2018, which is the next picture. My baptism. And I was baptized on October 28th. That is Pastor Hilton. And he says the exact same thing when I surrendered to the Lord. The exact same thing he said. And he goes, "Well, my sister in Christ, there's another beginning." And he was like saying things like, "I'm so proud of you." He was saying things like in a whisper tone because he had a mic and he was saying it in a whispery tone. He said to me, "You're going to do great things." I didn't get what that meant. But this is one of those great things, I believe. Anyway, so I got baptized and, he had very strong arms because he did not let me go all the way down. And that was pretty awesome because I was a little afraid of that. And so that was my baptism. And the joy that I felt that day was just the same. It was amazing for me. And I'm grateful that I can share it with every one of you. I bought this Oculus because of the fact that I just wanted to work out and never thinking that I would use it for such a blessing for my Lord. Never thought that that was even possible with an Oculus. So I'm very grateful for this opportunity. But I went to a Bible study. And it was a Bible study with Angel and Miss Wolf. And I've been going ever since. Bible study was amazing. And I continue to go. And the 13th of last month, I wasn't feeling very well. I had a lot of body ache and I really don't even remember what the Bible study was about because of the pain that I was in. And my voice was hurting really bad. So I pretty much kept to myself that day. And then Angel had asked if there was anyone who could prayer. And I went, "Yeah, I do. Because I know that I cannot do this alone." So, my brothers and sisters, I need you. I know that iron sharpens iron. That is so true. It is very true. So, Angel prayed and Miss Wolf prayed. And then I was going to attend another service with Pastor Lou. And that's where that song came in. Remember? And as I was listening to the sermon, Pastor Lou, at the end of the sermon, they played that song that we just heard, and that song is just now embedded in my head. I just can't stop playing it. And during that song, I had my mic off, or the sound off, and I realize I am singing at the top of my lungs. I'm standing up and moving. So, yes, he heals too. And I've never felt anything like that, and the rejoice that I had because of it. So I may be in this avatar form, speaking. He lives within us. And this is the way I look at it. Genesis 2, I believe it's verse 10. And he created man. He breathed into man. And that breath is within us. Always has been. Since day one, it has always been with us. All you have to do is twist that doorknob that is in the inside, twist that doorknob and open it and receive him as your personal savior. That's all you have to do. That's it. He'll work with you. I promise he will work with you. He clears the path. He clears the way. So that's my story. That's my testimony. Thank you.
This is a Red Nail's testimony. We're so proud of her. And she has a song that we're going to worship at the end to. And to get there, you just come around out of the corner right here. If you want to follow me over here, and there's a green button right here.
Do whatever you want to.
He
wants all of you, all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all of you. Give him all tonight. Give him all tonight. Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better. Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better.
Do whatever you want to. Come do whatever you want.